So my name is Benedict Gaster. I work at the University of West of England, where I'm a lecturer and a researcher. And in particular, over the last couple of years, well, last year or so, I suppose a couple of years depending, I've been looking at, I'm very interested in radio networks, but in particular, long-range, low-power radio networks for exploring the Internet of Things. And I'm going to take the moment, as this is the first session of the day in the Internet of Things track, to talk a little bit about what I think the Internet of Things is. I think it can have lots of meanings, but we'll look at the Internet of Things. I'll talk a little bit about low power, wide area networks in general. There's quite a lot of different solutions for this, and then I'll talk about the solution that we've been using. And in particular, there's LoRa, which is a radio connectivity, basically a Wi-Fi radio system developed by Semtech, originally from this French company that they purchased. And then there's the LoRa WAN part, which is basically a MAC layer and stuff built on top of the physical layer to make it useful with things. And then I'll talk about this really amazing group of originating in Holland, but now it's all over the world, called the Things Network, which basically provide a back-end infrastructure for building something that wants to connect to the internet, devices that want to communicate with the internet, effectively a cloud service. And the nice thing about them, certainly from my perspective, is that they are open source, they're open to everyone, it's free to use, and they are raising funds via governments and crowdsourcing and different things. And so it means you can pick up and use their services without having to pay a fee, which is certainly beneficial when you work at a university that doesn't have, well, has lots of money, but doesn't have lots of money they're going to give to you. And then I'm going to talk a little bit, well, actually, I've just got one slide right at the end about our project that we're doing in Bristol. And I haven't got any real details about it, but thing. And then tomorrow, there is a track which is associated with this festival, but it's more to do with Monica from Set Squared and IoT Boost, where we are, I've got some funding from the Digital Catapult and the government to encourage people to start to explore low-power wide-area networks, potentially using LoRa, because we're putting a network up just by Set Squared, but it doesn't need to be. It can be more than that, and it's just a way of kind of encouraging and incubating those things. Okay, and hopefully we'll have a bit of time for questions. All right, so the Internet of Things, this is a lovely stock diagram from Google, image from Google, about the ideas that we want to, you know, connect everything together, you know, this idea. And you'll see that a lot of the stuff you'll hear about is Amazon just down there, so I should say it pretty quietly. But this is the Amazon Dash. How many of you heard of Amazon Dash? Oh, a good amount of you. This is the idea that you put this thing, stick it to your fridge or stick it to your washing machine, and when you run out of shopping, because it's difficult to go to Tesco's and do that, then you can press this button and it will do the one-click purchase for you. It's an application of the Internet of Things. I'm sure it is, and I'm sure someone will want to pay for it, but not me, personally. This is, I suppose, certainly when I worked in Silicon Valley for a long time, and when I started to hear about the Internet of Things, as the next couple of years afterwards, everyone talked about Nest and their ability to control your heating and your thermostats and things from your phone. Again, difficult to find any motivation for myself personally, but you know, each of us have these different things. But the point is, it can be quite different things. A smart house, definitely, I can see, has some advantages. And for me personally, I think that we can say that these applications are fine, but I don't know if we really need a billion ways to buy something, okay? Because the thing they're saying, by 2020, we will have a billion devices connected to the internet, which aren't just the smartphones, because obviously we've already got a billion of those, just Android devices, but these little devices which are different in some sense. And what we define as being different, who knows? And by 2030, I think it's 20 billion or something like that. You know, the numbers are going up considerably, and the opportunities are huge, both if you want to make money out of it and make new products and or continue your range as Amazon does, but also to do change. You know, we could use this to monitor pollution in areas where we're doing that in a much more cost-effective and thing. It's being used in Pennsylvania to study pollution around and monitor pollution around fracking, for example. And people could just, the devices are cheap, they're easy to connect, and so everyone can get access to them. And so it really could change our lives. And, you know, I'm not saying that we shouldn't promote the economy. Of course we should. But it could do other things as well. And I hope that our research is trying to intend to do that. For example, we're working with Cardiff University to be able to parachute in little devices into disaster zones. So I don't know if this picture is from a war zone, but I think it's from an earthquake. And so one of the things in Italy recently, they had all these gas leaks after the earthquake and stuff and things, and this went on for days. And if we could drop in little devices and just monitor these kind of leaks and just lever the, you know, very easily, then that would be amazing. But of course, the likelihood of your 4G network still working around here after a huge earthquake is probably not that likely. You know, you're not going to have one. And so you want to be able to deploy something that can cover a reasonable distance fairly easily. So the idea is that we're going to actually drive trucks in with gateways on them and then drop. I mean, it looks nice for a research application, but drop little parachutes in, you know, with little devices around the place where you couldn't go. Whether that will actually happen, I don't know, but certainly driving things in. And I'll talk a little bit about a project that a student of mine's been doing at the end. 200 people a year in Bristol, apparently, killed by pollution. In Barton Hill, for example, we've got, there's a lot of problems because kids are arriving at school coughing and things like that. So, you know, and we want to be able to monitor that in a way that you could just take a sensor, put it into, attach it to a fence in a playground. And then it would automatically, you know, you wouldn't have to onboard it. You don't have the problem of getting that device connecting to the school network because they're probably not going to let you. Who even knows how well the school network will be run? We all know how good it is to get our access to via the Wi-Fi or whatever. So if we could do that much easier and cheap. So I went to a talk by Dyson recently, by Howard runs this IoT Bath and Bristol meetup. And the big thing they were saying, the biggest problem they have is that they've got this nice device, they want to connect it to the internet, and they have to get the user to type in their passwords, and then they want to send them an email, so they have to Google passwords and all these sorts of things. And so there's a whole thing which they call onboarding, which is a real complicated thing. We want to be able to make that much easier and accessible. So, for example, another project that we're doing, and again, I'm just giving you a couple of ideas of flavors of the projects that we're interested in doing. There's all sorts of things you could do. Is this is developed by Knowle West Media Center, and it's a little frog that just monitors humidity. It's going to particulate matters in the air, so you can kind of get an idea about the damp conditions in people's houses and so forth and things. Originally, they did this, and you know, it's a Raspberry Pi, and they had just a little SD card, so it would just monitor it. And then and someone had to go back to the house and get that SD card, transfer the information, and make use of it. You know, it was a really horrible process to have to do that all the time. And so someone stood up and said, well, you're all idiots. You just use Wi-Fi, right? They can just connect to their Wi-Fi and use their smartphones. So 25% of the houses that they put it in didn't have Wi-Fi in Eastern. And some things don't have, you know, so we shouldn't make those assumptions. It's really easy for us to make those assumptions, but it's not true. You know, I'm sure most of us in this room probably do have those access, but not everyone does. And so it's a kind of sliding scale of what we want to have access to. Okay, so from an architectural perspective, a high-level view, what do I see as the Internet of Things? You know, this is what we'll see, really, and this is not a picture from me, it's from the Things Network, actually. The idea over here is we have these blue boxes in the middle, which we call gateways. You can think of them as routers. They're basically just forwarding radio packets onto the Internet. You know, it's just a standard thing. It's not nothing new, just the same way. And the main thing about these gateways is that it actually handles, you know, the translation from radio physical layer into some sort of packet, which is the WAN part, the MAC packet. And, you know, these can be on all sorts of things. You could have them on bridges, you could have them on boats, and things like that, and they're just communicating. And one of the nice things, because we're interested in, I'll talk about this in a minute, long range. You know, we're talking about devices and that can communicate over kilometres, potentially, of distance. You know, they say, at least in the specs, up to 15 to 20 kilometres. Say personally, we haven't found that. We've found more 3 to 4 kilometres from actual practice. You know, there's obviously geography and all that has an impact. Line of sight is useful if you're on top of two tall buildings, but not that useful elsewhere. And things like that. And there's always drawbacks, you know, types of materials. But it does mean that we could potentially go outside of the urban area into you know, non-urban areas. For example, we're doing a project, hopefully, doing a project at Slimbridge, which is a wildfowl
area, that the wetlands, and it's really nice because it's only about 2 square miles, and if that's it, if we can get a couple of kilometres in distance, then we could have one gateway, and we could then put sensors, drop them in the Severn and stuff and things like that without having to. So it has a real advantage to go outside of urban spaces.
Okay. So it can be many things to many people, and what I was going to say is that what we really think about it and define it here is that we have these things which we'll call devices or nodes. I often call them nodes. We've got these gateways, and so this is the thing that's basically receiving radio signals and then converting them to IP packets. And from this point on, you're basically just standard, you know, on the internet, talking to a cloud service, hence the cloud bubble. Obviously, as I'll talk about this a bit in a minute, that it's all very secure. You know, the one of the key things that's been coming up during actually lots of the IoT Bath meetups, and there's a group now looking at this, is that security of these devices is a real issue, potential issue. You know, so this comes back to this onboarding. But even, you know, you've probably all heard about the I can't forget what it's called now, but the thing where from China they were doing this attack on the webcams, you know, and just getting the, because the passwords were just the default ones, and so they just went through them and generated them, and then they could use that to a denial of service attack. But here we're talking about wanting to be able to do full key based encryption, you know, where you onboard the device and do that, and then you're communicating in a secure network and things like that. And then, of course, from your cloud, however you get out of that, you get to your phone or to your website, wherever you want to get the information, to whatever the thing is, you're doing that. So I won't talk too much about that because it will take that. And I'll talk about this in a second, but one of the really important things is that the network is very easily extended just by installing new gateways. And I'll talk to you about how that works in just a second. The back end, again, you manage your applications via the cloud, and nothing new there, you know, just standard cloud services. And then, of course, you read your data out of the cloud, you transmit it, you know, via whatever service you want. MQTT is the default for the Things network, and how you display that on your devices is completely up to you. You know, that can be a web app, or it can be a closed wall app that's downloaded via the App Store, whatever. It's kind of completely independent. The really important thing from my perspective is that, and the Things network is really great for this, I'll talk about this, is that I see this purely as a conduit. It's just a place where the data temporarily appears so that you can distribute it out to your wherever you want. So that could be another server where you're storing your data, or it could be Catherine here from the council, she runs the Open Data Project, and that you could just be storing it in the open data site, you know, or whatever you choose. And this place is not really doing anything with your data. The Things network is such that I can't think what it is, but if you don't access the data within like 30 minutes or something like that, so you don't fall on, then it's gone. They don't store it. They store it for a set of time. And I don't know, but I'm pretty sure, I've never tried it actually, to be honest. I think you can actually limit that time as well. You could say that if you don't access it within 30 seconds, they'll delete it. So they don't store it. The advantage for them, of course, is that they don't need a lot of storage
because they've just got
this kind of like funnel with it, storing it temporarily. The advantage for you is that the data moves to wherever you want it to. And the licenses for them is that you are allowed to do anything you like with that data. So that's an important aspect too. Okay, so that's a little kind of bit of an introduction of what I think the Internet of Things is and what the you know, potential what devices could be. But now I want to look at specifically a certain area. So it could be lots of things, right? The Internet of Things could just be a smart home and it could use Wi-Fi. You know, or maybe it'll use Bluetooth because it's inside and everything. But that's not the area we've been looking in. We do use Bluetooth for quite a lot of stuff. But the thing I'm going to talk about today is outdoor networks, particularly designed specifically for outdoor and for long range. But the most important bit from my perspective is low power. So I want to be able to take one of these sensors,
plug it into the Severn, say, at Slingbridge, and not touch it for 2 years to gather data. I don't want to have to go out and change its battery and update it because that's really costly. Going back to Bristol City Council, with some networks are set up outside here, and they charge, I don't know what it is, but someone told me, in the figure of like £200 just to put a ladder up to get access to that. If you had to do that once a month, that's quite expensive, right? Even for a company that makes quite a lot of money, that would be expensive.
And so want devices that have got a life range of, we're thinking around 2 years for battery. Microsoft have set the standard at being 5 years. But for me, that's the number one most important thing, is the low power. And then we're using wide area just to limit that we don't have to have too many gateways. We want to travel the distance as far as possible. Okay? So it's just a type of wireless communication. There's nothing, I'm not going to go into loads of details about that, but it's not that different from, you know, Wi-Fi. It runs a different, the stuff we're looking at is 868 megahertz rather than 2.4 gigahertz, for example, for Wi-Fi. That has some benefits in terms of power, although you don't get as much bandwidth, clearly, and things like that, but you do get longer range as well, potentially. But it's just the communication. As I say, many kilometers of distance, and realistically, we have found about 2.4 kilometers in the Bristol city centre between gateways, we've found realistically. Now, what we don't quite know yet is whether that is because of the geography of Bristol.
As soon as we get on the other side, obviously you're not going to get the signal. But even so,
we haven't found it. And we did do some tests where we found line of sight was 4 or 5 kilometres. But even then, the RSI, which is the strength of the signal, was pretty low at that point, you know, or high, depending on which way you measure it. But realistically, we've found around 2.4 in Bristol. And so we're building a model, a probabilistic model based on ray tracing to kind of see if we can predict this and take it to other cities, because it's quite a few others. But we haven't got those results yet. So I just want to scale that back a bit. You often see in the literature 10 kilometers, 20 kilometers, maybe, but we haven't found that from empirical studies. The other key thing is that the bit rates are very low, okay? Okay, we're talking maybe, you know, 64 kilobits up to about 256 kilobits per second. And if you think about that, it's pretty low, right? If you wanted to fly, this is a 4K screen, you're not going to be sending 4K video over that. There's some other issues around, because we're talking in the unlicensed spectrum, which I'll come to in a minute, which means that the duty cycle, the amount of time you can actually send data in a particular phase, is limited as well, because it's unlicensed. And that's not a limitation of the LoRa technology in itself. That's a limitation that we're in the unlicensed spectrum. The advantage of being in an unlicensed spectrum is that you don't have to pay. You know, you don't have to have a SIM card. You're not paying the costs. The disadvantage is that you're limited by certain factors, such as duty cycle. Okay. We're interested in devices operated purely by battery. Now, this doesn't need to be. Again, there's no constraint on the technology itself. Clearly, in a smart home, you wouldn't necessarily want to do that, but there's work that we've been doing is specifically around battery, because then we can be agnostic. And you can see here about, if we look at battery life with respect to range, then I'm sure you've all found Wi-Fi pretty good, you know, to get good signals, high bandwidth, but it is, the battery life of it is not great. You know, you take your phone out, you're trying to look for a Wi-Fi signal all the time, and when it does connect, it can be pretty bad. And the same is for cellular. Cellular, you get much better range, but you're limited by battery again, still. And over this side, we've got things like Bluetooth, particularly Bluetooth low energy. When I talk about Bluetooth, I'm not talking about Bluetooth 2, I'm talking Bluetooth low energy, and more recently, Bluetooth 5, which has actually extended the range. Then you actually get pretty good battery life, but the range is still relatively short. You know, Bluetooth 5 is actually doubled, I think, the range from what they had previously, but you're potentially talking at most 500 to 800 meters. You know, you're not talking kilometers in distance. And so these other low power area networks aim to find a balance between battery life and range. And so we're going to look at the LoRa ones, but there are some other ones. Sigfox is one that comes up a lot. It's very popular. It's been used a lot for smart meters. Some cities in the UK have Sigfox networks being used for smart meters. Bristol apparently has a Sigfox network, which is actually covered, it's never been turned on. I don't know much more about that. I go into some meetings and some people talk positively about it, and other meetings and some people talk very negatively about it, but I don't have that much knowledge about the work. It seems to be, there's some politics involved there, which I stay away from. But it does have many of the advantages as LoRa has. I think they're a competing standard, they compete against each other quite well. There are some trade-offs in the costs of how you build gateways. Sigfox, you have to use a different chipset to the devices, which doesn't have to be the case for LoRa. And so gateways can be much more expensive with Sigfox, but then, you know, if you're building smart meters and electricity companies have lots of money, so they're probably not such an issue. You know, it just depends on what you're trying to do. So again, we can see the difference with data rates with respect to range. And so there is something I should mention, which I haven't got any information today, but I've noticed it's coming up more and more. So there's the NB-IoT, and I think there's one called NM-IoT as well, which is basically piggybacking off 4G technology. And so you can use a lot of existing cellular networks that already exist. And that has really nice range and things. It's all licensed, and so you have, you know, you will need a SIM card, so those sorts of things. There is actually one, I think the first one is being rolled out in Holland by one of the telecoms communications, and it's definitely a technology that I think will be worth looking at. You know, I'm not here to say that this one should be the one that we've picked on or whichever. For me, we're still exploring that, you know, and partly it will be what becomes the most cost-effective for people who want to use it. But of course, because it's piggybacking off the 4G networks, it's the cellular companies that are going to sell it to you, right? It's not going to be something that you can build yourself. Whereas with the LoRa, we're building our own things, and you'll see that. So it's a trade-off with what we want. They're less likely to put it in the middle of a desert or something where you might want to build a network, whatever. You know, there's a project with LoRa looking at rhinos and their location tracking of them. And there's the LTE stuff, obviously, that sits at the top. So LTE, Cat 1, and, you know, we're talking the 5G stuff that's all coming in, which is very short range, point to point, but incredibly high bandwidths. So we're told, you know, we'll wait and see. There's a company called Blue Wireless, I think based in Bristol. It is Blue Wireless, isn't it? Yeah. Who are some of the people I used to work with. And they're looking at that technology. And they have some actually set up around these lampposts around here. I think they may have been people who mentioned that. Okay. So a little bit more information about why I think these are interesting. You know, one of the things that we've discovered during our research and the work we've been doing is that messy networks are really interesting. What do I mean by this? Well, cell phone networks are very carefully positioned, okay? We have these, you know, imagine these are cell towers and the range is there. And notice there's hardly any overlap. There is a tiny bit of overlap just here, but it's controlled. It's very carefully planned with minimal overlap. And this maximizes the efficiency of the network. But the critical thing about it, and the reason they want to do this, is because they care about handoff. They care about handing it off between, you know, if you're walking between one cell tower and another one, anyone that you don't want to drop your call, okay? You really, really care about the quality. You know how annoying it is to go into a dark spot and lose your phone call or whatever and stuff and things. And so they really care about this. And a consequence of this is that they have spent a lot of money. This is real hard science has gone into making this work. And, you know, I don't mean the other stuff is not science, but it's a different type. So, you know, this has cost a lot of money doing research and design. You can find numerous papers on about cell tower layout and positioning and things. And people have spent, you know, I don't know what the money is, but a lot of money to make this work. And they care about that. But IoT networks, in particular LoRa networks, we care less about that. We can just get them to overlap and do all sorts of stuff. Okay, and here you can see we could have a gateway with some gaps in it. Okay, that would be a pain. You wouldn't be able to send signals in those gaps. But once you're building the network, you can build it fairly ad hocly, and it doesn't really matter. Okay, because the critical thing is that we don't care about handoff. We're not doing audio. We're just sending packets of data. If we have to resend it, that's fine. Okay, it doesn't matter if we lose packets. Okay, we don't carry calls, only messages. And the real idea here, I'm just using very intelligent here, is that, you know, this is the hard science, right? They can be fairly straightforward and basic devices to make this all work. And all they do is forward packets from a radio and translate that via a MAC layer and send it into the cloud. And so most of the smarts, there's a bit of smarts in the radio, although the radio's not that smart. I've done some frequency hopping and stuff and things, but nothing that smart. I mean, you know, I'm not saying it's not, I could build one out of scratch, but it's not that brilliant. And then once you've got the radio, the rest of it, as you'll see, you can build from a Raspberry Pi or whatever. It's pretty straightforward. Okay? So I think that the implication from my perspective is that with the help of open source hardware and software, people can build IoT networks themselves, right? And that's quite an empowering thing. If you want to build companies around that, you can do that, but also you can sell those things to people to build their own networks, as people are, or people in communities that might not have been able to have access to these things before can suddenly build this and do things. And that's where the Things Network came in. That was their idea. I don't claim it to be my idea. They realized that, and they built a whole ecosystem, including quite extensive cloud services, as you'll see in a bit, and everything that allows people to come in and build their own networks. Okay, so Laura. So it's based on radio modulation technology developed in 2010 by a French startup, Silo, and that was acquired by Semtech in 2012. Then a consortium of companies and other people got together and did a thing called LoRa for Wide Area Networks, called LoRaWAN, and they effectively are just adding a MAC layer to standardize it, you know, on top of the physical layer so that you can have a standard way of communicating and generating IP packets and so forth in a fairly straightforward manner. I mean, the document's only about 70 pages. Compared to some specs you read, it's not that complicated. It's fairly straightforward, you know, protocol.
If you're familiar with TCP protocols, it's not that different from that, really. It's actually simpler than that, actually. It doesn't have this great handshake.
But it's fairly straightforward. I should mention, I'm not going to talk about it today, but came up in one of our LoRaWAN meetups that we have around Bristol. There's recently a company, Complete Link Lab, they're called, I think, who have got this thing called Symphony. They call it Symphony, and it's a LoRa technology that is not based on LoRaWAN. They have their own MAC layer, effectively. And they claim that it's open, but it runs in licensed spectrum, and so it has some of the drawbacks that I talked about. It has some of the benefits. They're not restricted by duty cycles and things. So there are trade-offs, and I'm not proposing that one thing is necessarily better than the other. It will just depend on your particular application and thought. So the specification for LoRaWAN is completely open sourced. It's a LoRa Alliance. You can implement it and use it without certification. They do offer certification too, and the standard stuff. And the key features of it is that it has end-to-end encryption and security. So this is critical. data rate optimizations. So this allows you to, one, reduce the amount of data you're sending so you can manage it, but also the further you're away from a gateway, you can drop your amount of data that you send and still get a good signal or something. So they use these data rate optimizations to improve that. And it can provide quality of service, and there's different tiers. There's A, B, and C, I think they call them. And A is kind of like a bit like UDP, if you're familiar with that, just fire and forget, send it off, and, you know, hope and pray. And most of the time it gets there, right? If you're only taking a temperature sheet reading from your allotment or from your house, you probably don't need to worry about it if you miss one, right? If you're controlling some important thing on a industrial site, monitoring chemical leak or something, then maybe you do, you want to call. And so they have other ranges, B and C, which provide guarantees. And there are certain things about, you know, C, for example, it allows you to guarantee not only to send a message and receive an acknowledgement, but you'd immediately receive a download message from the gateway too, so you could update yourself. And you're guaranteed to get that within a respective time. We've only been using A because the spec for B and C only came out in the last couple of weeks. So they're laid out in star topologies generally. Best compromise between range of communication, number of base stations, and device battery life. Again, this is more from the Semtech and how they proposed it and the research that they did rather than anything that I've done. And the communication between device and a dedicated gateway is spread on different frequencies. So there's five different frequencies and channels and data rates, and this allows them to do hopping. And at any given time, you randomly select what you're going to do that to spread it, and that kind of reduces contention and the likelihood of losing packets and those sorts of things. As I say, the different data rates range, and that's just at the 125 kilohertz band, but we're not running at that. Adaptive data rates manages individual data rates of connected device, so that the gateway can actually manage the device's data rates for that, so it can control distance or things like that. And as I say, it's pseudo-random fashion to every transmission. You're changing channel to avoid conflicts. And standard, because it's in unlicensed bands, then we have these different ones for Europe and Asia and North America. No real surprises there, and it's all reasonably low, as you'd expect. And so this is the unlicensed spectrum, the one that we generally use in the EU 868. And the most important thing is that we have a limited duty cycle. So it's 1% per phase for devices and 10% for gateways. So I don't know if I'll have enough time to get to it, but the Things Network, they have this notion of what they call a fair use policy to try and to make sure that's fair. And so they have a thing that says that you can only be online, you can only communicate for a minute over in a 24-hour period. But if you think about the amount of data you're sending, if you're just sending a GPS location, that's quite a lot of minutes, right? Because you know you're sending tiny, I mean, it's only a minute, but you're only sending a tiny amount of data. So you can spread that quite easily. Now, if you wanted to send real-time data continually as a stream, and you were sending quite a lot, then you probably wouldn't be able to do that. Okay, so it really is application-specific of the kind of things you want to do. But if you're building a sensor to monitor humidity, because you've got stabilization of the everything of the sensor anyway, you're not going to be sending a continual stream. You're probably going to be monitoring it. We use, as I'll show, a little bike tracker thing that my students developed. He uses a GPS, which is you can power down, but it remembers the satellite location as long as you start it up again within, I think it's like 6 minutes, 20 seconds or some bizarre thing.
And it, so it automatically connects, and so you don't have this whole problem of having to search for satellites. So he sends it literally every, I think, 5 minutes, 45 seconds or something, or something, I don't know, something worked it out. But you can
completely power down and save power, so you get this longevity, and then you're nowhere near taking up that device amount of time. Oh. Okay, so this is what it looks like from a network perspective, and I won't go into this in detail, but basically it's a fairly standard, you know, networking stack that you'd expect. The critical thing here is you can see that everything is encrypted and going through that, and once you're into the gateway here, you need a secure connection with your back end, your backhaul server, like this, and everything is in. So and it's encrypted from there through and to the back end, and so even here you couldn't interpret or look into the messages being sent. So it's tricky to hack. I'm not saying it's impossible. Obviously, clearly you could sniff it, for example, it's a radio transmission, but you know, unless you've got the keys, it's going to be not that trivial to break into. They're really cheap, right? Relatively, $8 or €8 for a single LoRa board plus the software stack, that's including everything, and that's if you just buy one of them. Okay, so here's a board with one of the microchips on it here that we've designed. And this microchip is a company that make LoRaWAN chips and stacks running a Cortex M0 with the software stack plus a little bit of radio and all the noise stuff, you know, to do that. And that costs €8, right, when I bought one of them. So clearly, if you're going to buy thousands of them, then, you know, the price will come right down. You know, it's pretty cheap. And this whole board, ST, a Cortex M4 here, running on this, you know, this whole board with design and everything, even though we've only got 10 of them, we could make for £20. And that, you know, we're not doing large productions of them, we just design this ourselves. And so it's very cost effective. There's the chip I was talking about. I'm going to move on a bit. Very simple to program. This is just not the code we're using because we're using an ARM chip, but this is taken from an Atmega Arduino piece of code that the Things Network give, because they make a little board based on the Arduino. And really simple code. The actual code for this chip is programmed by UART and simple, you know, serial messages to, there's three layers. It's got version, chip information, it's got configuration of connecting to the network, and it's got sending messages, and they're really straightforward, you know, stuff. And so the code is trivial to develop. And so that means it's really easy to build your own devices. You know, you could, I'm just use Arduinos, just because whatever you want to do. With one of the little breakout boards, we designed our own little breakout board for this chip, separate from that, and literally just wire it up. And mostly that code, plus a bit more to send messages, and you're actually sending messages over the thing. It's really trivial, you know. And if you actually look at the library, which I've written my own RN2XX in this language called Rust for this board, and, you know, it was a couple of days in the evening's work. It's actually really trivial because most of the smarts is done on the Cortex M0 that sits in here. Okay? And you can buy off-the-shelf ones if you just want to get going. Of course, you know, quite often useful when you're initially prototyping a product to buy an off-the-shelf one, and you can do just that. I've got to think how much time I've got left. 10 minutes, that's good. So nothing really. But what about the gateways? Well, so the gateways are a bit more, the devices themselves can actually connect to any network, right? You don't really, assuming that you're all running at 8.6.8, then your device, you could build this device. Now you'd have to tweak the software a little bit, but there's nothing in here that would stop me from connecting to the Things network or equally connecting to another LoRaWAN network that you've built, you know, with your own backend. But at some point, you need to have something that's going to communicate with the backend, and that's the gateway. The gateway, for me, is the place where that makes a choice. Again, most of that software, so you could report it, but we're using a gateway that's designed on the Things network software stack. I mean, again, it's not a particularly complicated software stack, but it would need a bit of work to do that. And you can see how this works from a gateway perspective. You've got the LoRaWAN stack, which and the regional bands happening in this. This can be on the device. And on here, you've got this handling. So this is the radio chip here, right? This is all just off-the-shelf stuff. And actually, the yellow box for us is off-the-shelf. And then this bit here, the encapsulating forward, is purely just software. It's actually a very simple just packet forwarder implementation. And at the moment, the one we're using connects completely to the Things network. But again, it's not. I mean, we're talking, you know, 1,000 lines of fairly straightforward C code. So it's not going to be hard to port. I mean, you know, and to get it to do your own thing as well, if you wanted to. So there's no real tying. Even if you develop this whole stack using the Things network to prototype it, at the end of the day, there's nothing that would really cost you other than, you know, maybe a man, you know, a bit of work. I'm not going to say any specific time to port that to another network. And so there is an advantage that you can get things going really nicely. And if you want to productize it, go into a licensed spectrum or whatever, that transition would not be too difficult. You can build gateways from Raspberry Pis. This is the radio board over here. It's called the contractor that does the communication really straightforwardly, completely open source. And this is what's incredible about this. This is a whole gateway built from scratch, including the antennae, and you know, approximately €200. Right, that's incredible. That does mean that if you want to prototype something, it's really straightforward to do. But also, if you want to build your own network. So we're working with this province just outside of Rome. They've got, I think what it is, maybe €200,000. It's an incredible amount of money they got just from the Roman, from the Italian government to build a LoRa network. So a great thing for me is they're flying me out there for a month in the summer to go and work with them. And yeah, but you know, these are €200. And they've got €200,000, so you can see where they might get to. You know, and their goal is actually to have six. They're using it. They want to train some of the citizens and stuff to use it and build their own network. So it's not that's just that. But it's incredibly easy. Just for a few weeks, we talked with them, with the government in Italy, and with these two people who are running the project, and they realised that, you know, by the summer we could be deploying it and building their own network without having to go through doing a contract with other companies and things like that. It was quite empowering for them. Institution. This is what it looks like. A bit more complicated when you start to actually think of what the back end looks like. And so the back end is quite a complicated piece of software. And there's a thing that handles most of this is really to do with, you know, how you're going to distribute the load for what's coming in from different nodes to different parts of the cloud services that they provide and things like that. And so this is the bit that happens here. And then they have tools for debugging and development. This is a basically you can emulate just on command line tools a whole, you know, a LoRa device, so you can develop your back end completely independently of your device itself, and then only connect them when necessary. Clearly, you could be propagating the device information and testing it locally just by having a gateway that forwards it to yourself rather than goes out to the cloud. So it is designed in a scalable way from a software development and design perspective as well. And then clearly you just connect. MQTT is the standard way. They have another node one as well, which I prefer node. But so you can get the information out of their system into your system very straightforwardly. Anyone who's familiar with, they have a nice REST API that allows you to do that and those sorts of things. Here's a little bit of node. I don't know who's familiar with JavaScript, but this is the complete thing that will allow me to connect to my app. You notice that each device and application, so a device could has two unique identifiers, one for the device and one for the app that it's kind of performing. And these are 64-bit unique identifiers. And then clearly you've got keys and things like that for doing that. you know, handling all of that. But this is the whole code that allows me to connect to my device that's sending GPS. And here it's just printing out, you know, to the console. It's not doing anything interesting, but I'm consuming that information from the things network with what, you know, 20 lines of JavaScript code, right? You know, and even my 8-year-old daughter could write this. Okay, so I'm just going to finish up with a little example of something that one of my students did. So it turned out there's a lot of bikes stolen in Bristol every day. I won't go into that. Here's a little drawing when we first met up about what we wanted to do was be able to put the little device, which is this is a simple GPS device that's sending messages about the location, has a gyro on it as well to detect movement, and we stick it inside the frame. It's not actually stuck in the frame at the moment. It's just sellotaped to under the seat because, you know, we really want to cut his bike up. But it's really straightforward. This was a little diagram that we came up with when we first did it, when we first met to discuss the project. And he is a good student, I can't deny it, but let's see if this is going to work. So this is his little application. And again, the way that the Things Network works is that you can go into their website and manage all your devices and all of that, but they provide APIs for everything. You know, it's a typical web service, you know, REST APIs. So you can design your own application, add your own devices via here without any, they don't even need to know that it's a Things Network. And so that, again, that makes it nice and easy to port from things. So this is simple. You can add new devices and add it. We've got one added or editing ready, and we can just select it here. And then I think if we zoom in, hopefully it won't work now. Well, it never works when you want it to. So start monitoring, sorry. Okay, and there it is. So this is data that he gathered via the LoRa. He lives in Kingsdown, and he cycled his bike around and just gave it because we've got an antenna that reaches that. This is CAN data, though. This is not him riding around on his bike live, but it was exactly, it's just feeding it.
By TCM, that command line tool that I've got, you know, he generated all the data just in a MongoDB database, and now he's just feeding it into this. But there's nothing stopping from that being a live stream. It just isn't. Okay? And, you know, he's a good third year student, but it really wasn't that tricky to get all this going and prototyping. You know, this is a fully prototype system now.
You know, and obviously it's not product by any means, but, you know, it's not that difficult. And you can build this today in Bristol because we have covered the whole of the Bristol city centre with LoRa WAN things. Monica, who's at Set Squared and is based at the Engine Shed, we will have a new gateway next week going up for that as part of the IoT Boost project, which if you're coming tomorrow, you'll find out more about to build that and test that. And again, I'm not arguing, well, I mean, I suppose I am a bit, but I do believe in it, that LoRaWAN is necessarily the solution to all the IoT things, but it is a great starting point for building low-power wide area networks, which are actually really cheap. So, you know, you could be a small company, startup company, or you could even be an individual and you can reasonably build this stuff and get it going, you know. We got this whole network going
with a very small amount of money, you know, relatively. I think we spent to date, if you don't include my time, because there's many evenings, but, you know, a couple of £1,000. You know, and we have got some pretty fancy antennas. We've been a very high gain, four-wave antennas going up. We've been very lucky, I should say, Bristol Wireless, which is a group or a small non-profit organisation who can place there, and they have access, Bristol City Council gives them access to very strategically placed tower blocks around the city that we've been able to install our antennas on
to get the maximized coverage, you know. But even so, you know, I've got one from my house. It covers the three blocks around my street, you know, where at my house and stuff and things, so we could do it locally. We can reach our allotment, and my wife is now I'm building the sensors, but she's designing sensors so she can monitor the temperature and the weather at our allotment. All right, so I think I'll stop there. I have got lots more, but I'll put the slides up and we can talk about that, because I think it's...
Yeah, I just thought I'm already over. All right, is there any questions?
So the range that you mentioned earlier about 2.5 kilometers in the city environment, was it using the big antenna that tower for?
So the range I talked about was indeed using we have 3 gateways installed. One in Windmill Hill, which is if you remember, it's on top of Pitt Hill, and it's up there. And then one
in Easton, just by the St. Paul's roundabout, and then one in Kingsdown. So you kind of get this nice triangle of the city, if you think. And the range is from those high ones. Yes, we're doing that. And but we, for example, I live in fish ponds, and a line of sight, I was getting an RSI about 90, so not brilliant, but that's about 6 miles, if you see what I mean, from that particular antenna. So you can get it, but it is literally like, you know, I can, if I got a telescope, I'd be able to see it. Do you know what I mean? And so I think, so it's worth noting that when we used it at lower range, from my house, for example, I use a 3 dBi gain, you know, antenna with a ground plane. And there I'm seeing, even with houses in the way, maybe like a kilometre, you know. But I couldn't say, because we live, you know, pretty soon we get to some dips, do you know what I mean? And so it's hard to know exactly. So I think we need to build a model. We're building a probabilistic ray tracing model to kind of predict what we should see, and then using some building materials and things like that. But I don't have that information yet. But yeah. Any other questions? Yes, absolutely. So this is one right here. Yeah, Farnell.
Who made them?
So they're made by Microchip. I don't know where they're made. They're probably made in China, but then you can't export them to China. It's kind of bizarre, you know, so you can't get them bought. But Farnell is, you know, a UK company that, and you can just buy them on there. And I think they're about £7. You know, so it's not a one-to-one translation with euros. We bought ours from this German company. This here is a completely self-contained device. Yeah, it has a Cortex M0 plus the radio chips, and it's literally just got it's got a bunch of other pins, but if you only care about, you know, it's got clock, TX and RX, power and ground, and you just talk to it by this simple serial interface. Yeah. And one of my students, who's more of a hardware engineer guy, he is actually taking the LoRa chip and by itself, you know, so not that, and put his own Cortex M0 and got its own LoRa WAN standards open sourced and run on that. But there's actually, the problem with it is that, I don't know why, but the way that the radio, there's a lot of, you need a lot of circuits to avoid interference and some things, and that's all inside this chip, so it didn't really work out that cost effective. You know, unless you were going to build like 10,000 devices, it just made more sense to buy these, to be honest, for us. Yes.
I work really close to the engine shed, so it's interesting. You said the gateway's getting stood up there. Is it next week? Oh, thank you.
So the new gateway at the engine shed. What's the easiest and quickest way to start interacting with that gateway, given that I've never done anything with LoRaWAN before?
Oh, okay. Well, so the easiest and quickest way is to, if you just want to do it straight off the box without anything else. Oh, sorry, my wife is sending a... Where's it gone? It's so the Things Network, and actually you can get Farnell, they've just done a deal with Farnell actually, and they make this little, basically Uno, you know, Arduino Uno compatible board, so you can program it from Arduino. I mean, I don't use that, but, and you can just buy that, and then you'll be up and running on the Things Network within an hour, I suspect, particularly okay. If you've had some sort of programming experience before. Yeah,
yes.
Within an hour. I mean, it's fairly, they're really quite good. I have to admit that their off-the-shelf solution just for playing around with it and prototyping it is perfect. The nice thing is it's got lots of pin breaks out, so you can start doing, you know, external sensors attaching to it and stuff. So the Things Network Uno, it's called.
Great.
And that you can order on Farnell. Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Is it time to stop? Oh, one more question and then we'll stop. Yep.
In your slides, you mentioned this basically open source gateway, and we basically try to play with that. Do you think those connections that you use with the wires can limit the range to not 2 kilometers, only hundreds of meters sometimes? The open source
gateway
that you mentioned, I mean, we have tried to set up that, and
we do not
experience a very long range.
You haven't experienced very long range.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
So is it Is it possible because of those wires that are causing the interference, some kind of interference?
I wouldn't have thought so. Most likely it's the antennae that use it. That's what we found was the biggest difference.
Okay.
And we did find, and I have to say that one of the things I found misleading by the Things Network on some of their forums and also on the center, they claim that you can use like these little quarter wave things, and that hasn't worked well for the gateways for us.
Okay.
I mean, partly because, you know, if you use a higher gain, larger antennae on your gateway, then you can have you can reduce the size of your antennae on your device and still get a reasonable. Right, so that's what we've wanted to do. But yeah, I think there's still quite a bit of work to do about that. And I never did believe everything I read online, but some of the claims are not realistic. You know, in the same way that someone claims that Wi-Fi battery will last the week or something, you know, they're not realistic, right? You know, and there's still a lot of research to do in that area, I think, to be honest.
Yeah.
You know. Yeah. Okay. All right, I'll stop.